My heart been singing for years. How could it not when you told God is good? But it turned out he better than what he appears. Heart of David, the wisdom of Solomon.
What's up, fam? Welcome back to the Time is Right podcast. My name is Scott Smith, and I am your host. Here on the Time is Ripe, we are a podcast of Ripe Creatives, which is a ministry that leverages the arts for the purpose of mission here in the city of Philadelphia. And the Time is Ripe is a podcast of this wonderful thing where we go back in time to talk about things that happened in the Ripe Creatives community, events that we produced or put on for the city of Philadelphia, or other events that we got asked to come be a part of and participate in. Today's episode, I think, is really, really special. It was one of the biggest events of the entire calendar year in the city of Philadelphia. And about, probably 8 to 10 of us within the Ripe community got to play a part in one way or another. And that, of course, was the Xtend Conference on August 12th, 2023. It was hosted at the Met Philly, the iconic Met Philadelphia in North Philadelphia near Temple. And it was an amazing, amazing conference, probably the largest youth conference Philadelphia has seen in decades, something that I think is a really important movement here in the city. And I'm so excited for us to get to talk about it through the lens of Ripe and to share the whole story. I got a couple of amazing guests in the room. Of course, we have Top Mop Moses from Top Mop Productions, Jared Moses in the room, but not on a microphone today. Thank you for being here and making this whole thing happen. Shout out to you. We also got Aable back on the microphone.
How you doing?
Hey, there he is. TB's back. Not Tom Brady, the other one. Aable is one of the artists in our community, and he's been on a bunch of these episodes over the last two seasons, and it's always good to have Aable's voice on an episode. We also have two other guests on this episode of Time is Right, and both of them are first-timers. One of them is hoping that it's a first and last opportunity for them because they've been bugging out as we've been getting ready for this. I'm just teasing. For the first time ever, Joseph Novales is on the microphone with us.
Hey, guys. This is Joseph.
The goat.
Yeah, we make goat noises for
the goat.
Our really talented friends.
Yes, Joseph Novales is an amazing, amazing person. We love him so much. We've gotten connected to him through a whole bunch of different things. I'll let him introduce himself in just a second. We also have one other guest, first timer as well. We have Miss On Ty in the building. And these two have never been on Time is Right before, and we're hoping we can get them on future episodes, but depends on how this one goes. I mean, let's be honest. Joseph, you're up first. I would love, as a first-time guest, we always have first-time guests, explain who they are and introduce themselves a little bit. So for our listeners who have never heard your voice before, JoJo, who are you? How'd you get connected to Ripe? All those things.
All right. My name is Joseph. I got connected to Ripe through a friend. So I met Rashid, Emily, Liv. That's Rashid St. Fleur, Emily Phillips, and Olivia Weatherby. I met them through a ministry called Headwater House. I hit it off with Rashid pretty instantly. And afterwards, we became friends. And then he invited me into this crazy, interesting world that is Ripe. And yeah, that's how I got connected to Ripe. And then I met Scott, and he just convinced me to join. And then...
He's pretty good at that.
Is that what happened?
Yeah.
It's one of his greatest gifts.
Partially against my will, but here I am.
Here you are.
Like over a year later.
A year and a half later.
Yeah.
Joseph does a lot of things for Ripe, and he shoots almost all of the photos for our Creatives Philly events and even some of our outside events as well. He's an amazing photographer, even though he doesn't flex that muscle too often outside of Ripe these days. But he's an amazing, amazing photographer, one of the best photographers you'll ever see. And then he also is a worship leader and a really incredible worship leader as well.
Buttery vocals.
Buttery vocals.
That's crazy.
Can't wait for you to hear his voice on some
records. Can't believe it's
records.
Not butter.
Can't believe it is butter.
Can't believe it is butter.
But Joseph's a part of Ripe Worship as well. Long way of saying he has a lot of different things. You do other things too. You make graphics.
I do a little bit of everything. Whatever Mr. Scott needs, I'll do.
Oh, Mr. Scott.
Whatever Scott needs, I'll do.
Yeah. Thanks for that, Joe. I appreciate it. Yeah, thank you for being on this episode. Excited to have you on. What about you? Give a little bit of your context for who you are, what you do, and how you got connected to Ripe.
Sure thing. So I'm on, and I kind of have gotten to know Ripe in the same way as Joseph. I met a lot of the people through the creative ministry at the time called Headwater House, and just fell in love with the people. So I just had the privilege of living life beside these people, and I knew that they were a part of something called Ripe. I just never fully understood what it was, but I knew that they were creative people, artists at different, you know, in different spheres. And I just always admired how they worshiped the Lord in different ways, through rap, through singer-songwriter, through worship, through dance at times as well, or at least it was through the ministry at the time. But I just fell in love with the people, and the more that I hung out with them, the more Scott tried to convince me to join.
I told you he's good at that.
That's true. I'll tell you what, On is not lying. Joe might have been lying. No, I'm teasing.
But I always, my interest was always there, but I've never been the person to like insert myself into things, because honestly, I've always had a lot going on anyway, so I didn't want to do just another thing just because I thought it was cool. Like, if I was going to be a part of something, I need to know the heart behind it. And I think that it became pretty evident the more that I hung out with people who were in it. So unintentionally, they were telling me about the heart of Ripe by just being themselves and allowing me to be in their lives. But yeah, so that's how I started to know people and knew of Ripe in that way. But I'm on currently freelancing photography, videography. I also love music, so I've written and produced some, and I love collaborating with other people. I just love art in general, visual and audio wise. So any chance I get to dabble in any of those things, I will be there.
Yes.
She's an artist in hiding, everybody.
We're trying to
pull her out to the world.
I've been in a cave.
You can find her music out there in the world. On Ty on Spotify.
On Ty, spell it for the people.
A-N-H-T-H-A-I. A-I. I almost said I-A, and I was like, that doesn't sound right.
On Ty.
I'm a bad speller. I think I have dyslexia on the low. On also is a worshiper. Worship leader in a bunch of different places, but specifically at Xtend, which we're going to talk about today, with CityReach Worship, which Joe is the leader of. So shout out to both of them for being a part of this episode. Now, Joe, before we get into talking about August 12th, 2023, the day of, and we talk about Aable's involvement in that, I would love for you to just give maybe a little bit of a history lesson of Xtend. Because this was started by your church specifically, and shout out to your church, CityReach Church, Pastor Mark and Wanda Novales, who happen to be your mom and dad.
Mom and dad.
Hi, mom. Hi, dad.
Hi, mom.
I love you, daddy.
Stop. Mark and Wanda, amazing people. We've gotten to know them over the last couple of years, mainly through you, Joe. And they started this conference, but I think what's been beautiful is, you know, the heart from the beginning, I think, was for it to expand beyond CityReach and become of the Big C Church of Philadelphia's youth conference. It just needed some pioneers and jump starters to get it going. But can you share a little bit about the history of Xtend?
Yeah, there's so much history to it. I'm trying to figure out what I should say. But about 4 or 5, maybe even 6 years ago, at the time I was in our church's youth group ministry, and we used to go to a yearly, youth conference of like 60,000 students in the South in Alabama. And, it was an amazing experience. We were, super empowered and inspired, but the drive was like 16 hours, 18 hours. And we'd come back home to Philly and we would be like, oh man, like that was great, but now we have to wait a whole other year to experience something like that, or drive or save up money for a plane ticket, or any of those issues that come with travel. It was just so far away. And so I remember a bunch of us approaching the pastor's mom and dad and leadership at the time. And we're just saying, like, why couldn't we do something like this in our neighborhood or in our city? And so nothing initially happened at first. It kind of was just a thing that we had thought of, and nothing was birthed from it. And then we ended up, I think maybe 2 or 3 years later, two new leaders stepped into leadership over the youth group, Pastor David and Samantha, shout out to them. An amazing couple. And they kind of came in with fresh vision and just like, we're on fire for the Lord. And I remember sitting down with Pastor Dave, and he said, "What do you guys think about a conference?" I was like, "What the heck? We've been talking about doing a conference for years." And so from that, we just started planning. And obviously, we never thought it'd be in the Met or in anything of that scale. We did it the first year. I forget the exact year. It might have been 2019, 2020. When did I meet you?
I think it might have been 2021, because that's when I came back.
Yeah, maybe it was 2021. It was one of the 20 years. And we did the first one at our church. We planned for about 200 people, and we had almost 500 youth come. And so outside of just the number of it, we just could tell that there was a need for it, and that our youth group wasn't the only one who was hungry for something like that. And so, yeah, then we... At the end of the first one we did in our church, my dad stood on the sanctuary, Pastor Mark, and he said, "Next year we're going to be in the Leah Corps Center." And all of us were like, "What the heck is this man talking about?" My dad is crazy. Well, crazy is not the best word, but he is a crazy man of faith. He has faith unlike anybody that I know. And so, lo and behold, a year goes by. We plan. We put in so much work, so much sweat, so much of my life that year revolved around Xtend. And the second year we held it at the Leah Corps Center, which was just mind-boggling. It was crazy. Nothing to that scale really I've ever seen happen in the city. And yeah, it was just mind-blowing that we were actually able to do it, and we actually pulled it off, and that that it happened. And so when we got together to start planning for 2023, we knew that it was wisest, and that the Lord was leading us to the Met. And so, yeah, we walked in that. Yep. We're obedient, and the Lord opened every door that had to be opened.
Amazing. Thank you for the three scale. So I personally did not know anything about Xtend when it was just at your church. Because in a lot of ways, you know, your youth group at the time was also called Xtend Youth. And so naming the conference after the youth ministry, in some ways it felt like, oh, that's their, just their youth conference. And as the burden for a much larger need for the city was kind of being birthed, you know, really through your dad's vision, and then obviously through Pastor David and Samantha, like, kind of carrying it out, and this thing becomes bigger, you know, it became like obvious, like, oh, this is not just City Reach's thing. This is for the city at large. And, you know, I wanted to be there. So I remember even making a commitment just to be at Xtend last summer, to where I blocked off the date probably like 6 to 8 months ahead of time, just to make sure I was in the room, because I knew it was important to be at. And I got to see it. You know, it was at Leah Corps. Leah Corps is where Temple University plays basketball. It's a big, you know, Coliseum-esque auditorium, you know, very large scale room with a whole lot of seats. And it was kind of amazing to see a ministry conference happen in that room. And I remember, you know, we're there, and, you know, my one piece of negative feedback about Xtend last year, which I gave to your mom and dad, like, this isn't a surprise, was, man, I feel like there's some people that are local that are just as good as anybody that you guys brought in from, you know, further away, that might be a good fit for Xtend, instead of, like, you know, flying somebody in from Atlanta or flying somebody in from Florida or Texas to come minister. Like, there's amazing powerhouse people that are just as skilled and just as talented, but maybe not as well known right here in the city of Philadelphia, which, I mean, obviously your parents listened to that feedback, you know, and I think really appreciated it. So, yeah, coming out of Xtend last year, you know, that was the initial conversations for Ripe stuff. And then I remember going to, I want to say it was One City, One Love that September, in the lights thing, your church, Pastor Jamie Centeno runs it at the Dell. And at One City, One Love, your dad came up to me and was like, hey, we got to talk about Ripe and Xtend next year. I really want to talk to you about this. And that's where kind of the conversation started. So I was asked to host it. And Aable was booked to perform. DJ Angie was booked to perform. But then also locally, Resonate Worship from Jersey. It's kind of a collective. A couple of our Ripe singers, Ripe Worship people are in Resonate. We're asked to be a part of it. A couple other people in our community were asked to shoot for it. Rashid and Ralph shot a lot of the content. And then CityReach Worship, the worship team from your church, Joe and On, was also booked on the conference. And a handful of the Ripe Worship people were actually in CityReach Worship as well. So in all, there was like probably 10 of us that were in this space that were planned to be a part of Xtend 2023. So that's kind of where that overlay happened. Aaron, I would love to hear from you. Sorry, we've been talking a lot, trying to give context, but now we can get into the nitty gritty. Aaron, for you, when you first found out, like, hey, Xtend's hitting you up, Aable's getting books for Xtend, like, what were some of the feelings that you felt about the opportunity coming?
Initial feelings were disbelief, I think. I don't know. I feel like my journey with music has been very me just, like, taking it one day at a time. And, you know, trusting God to really open the doors. I don't really feel like I know what I'm doing. So I don't think I ever expected for, you know, to be trusted with a platform like that. You know what I mean? I think I just don't view myself like I deserve that. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's where I'm supposed to be. So I think when we knew about Xtend Conference, I did have thoughts like, no, this probably makes sense for me, someone like me, to be a part of, just because of what they're looking for in having an artist that does hip hop music. And just because our communities are so connected, like, it just seemed like, it would probably make sense if I was a part of something like that. But I never actually thought it would happen, if I'm being honest. So I think Scott reached out to me and he shared that they're strongly considering it. And I was just like, I just remember being like, wow. Like, you know, I felt like, wow, God. And like, why are you so good? I think that was really, you know, how I felt. I'm sure we'll get into like the day of and how I felt then. But
yeah,
initially just finding out in general was just like, this is really cool, because we're all connected. I feel like this is something I want to do because I love the people there already. So the fact that it was actually happening, I think, was exciting for me.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I mean, it's not to oversimplify it, because I think it is the Lord's provision, right? Like, favor is, that's God's move, right? He's the one that gives people favor and puts favor on people's lives to give them, you know, put them on the hearts of people to open doors. But in the midst of that supernatural thing happening, I do just want to say it makes sense, right? I just think that for things happening in the city of Philadelphia, ministry focused, trying to leverage the arts, I think by the grace of God, like, we should be the first call in some ways, because of, we've been at this for a while, you know, like, this isn't something that we're just conjuring up, even as crazy as everything feels, or how we're just like trusting God with the next thing. I think it does make sense for an Xtend as it grows and develops, is like, yeah, like, we should hit them up if we want to involve artists before just bypassing who's here on boots on the ground committed to the city. Because that's my only issue with like booking outside people sometimes, is they're only here for 2 days, right? And then they're gone. And that's okay. And they might have a powerful ministry that's supposed to just drop a seed and leave. But I think it's always better whenever you can have somebody that's in a room that those young people can actually see in a week, or see in a month, or see in 60 days, instead of needing to wait, like you said, a year for the next encounter with that person. So yeah. I just think from a ministry perspective, it makes sense to go local when you can, when that's a possibility.
Yeah.
Joe, like you were part of the planning, right? Yes, you were in the room from the very beginning. Like from your perspective is what I'm saying, you're, like how you guys viewed it in that room. And then we'll get into like some of the preparation stuff.
Yeah, for sure. I think there's a beauty of the balance of it. Because I definitely think like what you're saying is true. Like supporting the people that are on, like, I think of it like boots on the ground. The people that are actually pouring into the city and that are working on spreading the gospel through their craft. I think highlighting those people, it just makes sense, like what you're saying. I also think there is something beautiful about bringing like an artist from across the country that these kids have grown up seeing, or like these are the, I sing their songs on my Sunday services, or I watch all their YouTube videos, or not in like a stardom or like a fan kind of way, but just like, these are people that inspire me, or I got saved by listening to this person's song and now I can see them in person. So I think there's still a beauty of the balance. And I think this year I feel like we got that. We got a beautiful balance of people that, like, I know some of those people in the crowd probably go to church with you, Aaron, and same with us, like me and An, like people from our church got to see us lead them. But at the same time, they got to see bands and groups that otherwise they would only see on a video on YouTube.
Yeah.
So I think in that sense, there's this beauty of like having both.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Mm. Yeah. The lineup artists and worship teams wise was Resonate, City Reach, and Aable were kind of the three local.
Yeah.
And then you had Elevation
Rhythm,
and UpperRoom. So anybody else I'm missing? Just the speakers, right?
Yeah, for worship.
Mark and Hannah.
That was it for worship. Yeah, that was it for worship. Yeah, Resonate.
Yeah, yeah. So it's kind of like a mixed bag, you're right, like local and then still having Elevation Rhythm and UpperRoom there. And both of them were amazing. And it's not a shot against them. I think it's more just affirming you guys as CityReach Worship and Resonate. It wasn't that massive of a gap between what you guys do and these people who do this full-time 24/7 all over the world. And I think that's just a testament to Philly culture and Philly church culture and worship culture in this city. Like, God's blessed us with skills too, you know what I mean? So I think it was beautiful to have both, like you said. But it didn't seem like, oh, here's the local people and there's the big people. Everybody was excellent. Everybody stewarded their time really well, and God moved through all of it, is all I'm saying.
Yeah, no, for sure.
You know, so let's talk about the preparations from the team end to just get things together. It's a massive undertaking. Xtend, you know, like you said, half of your year is probably spent on this conference. Maybe not as much anymore, but that first year at the Lea Course was a lot. That was crazy.
It gets more, but yeah.
You think it's worse now?
Oh, well, we start earlier now. We start earlier and earlier. Okay. So
it's a little less intense at once.
Yeah.
But yeah, Xtend, you know, you guys picked to do it at the Met. I think God definitely guided you guys in that direction. And I think it was a perfect size kind of space for where things are and opportunities to grow as well. What do you remember anything in terms of like, hey, we want to do UpperRoom and Elevation? Like what some of those reasons were to book those groups specifically, or is it just kind of something you guys felt like? I'm just thinking in terms of the preparation leading up to the conference, anything that sticks out there?
Well, in terms of preparation, I mean, there's so many things that go into that. But for those two groups specifically, for UpperRoom and Elevation, when we initially had sat down early last year and we're like, if we could bring anybody, who would we bring? And we said Elevation Rhythm. I think they had just released an album, and they make music that, in my opinion, is not really created by anybody else. And like Christian music, like just the kind of music they make and like the demographic that they serve, I think it's very unique. And I think they do it very well. And so we thought about Elevation Rhythm, and we also thought about UpperRoom. I'm super inspired by UpperRoom and their ministry and kind of like the tone that they have set in the worship culture. Of just like worship culture, how they lead and how they inspire others to just pursue the heart of the Lord. So those two bands came up and we said, okay, well, let's just reach out to both of them. Whoever answers first, we will go with. So we were able to figure out contact, and we reached out to both bands, and both bands responded pretty much within a week. And they both had the same sort of requirements and same sort of like honorarium budget. And so we were like, okay, so now how do we decide? And initially we did kind of settle on one of them. And then my dad, again, just man of faith, said, well, what if we get both? And so it worked out where we were able to have both Elevation Rhythm and Upper Room come. But I mean, as far as preparation for the conference, it's just so many layers to that. Like pulling off a day event takes a year of preparation. And the amount of work we're doing is like the amount of work for like 3 years, especially in those months before. But yeah, it's a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. Shout out to you guys.
Shout out to the team. Yeah.
Yeah. They asked me to be a part of the weekly planning call thing. And I was like, this is not what I signed up for.
He came a few times.
I came digitally. Huh. Yeah, I was not going to make that drive across the city every week during rush hour. But yeah, I mean, I definitely joined some of the calls. But, you know, I mean, my heart in it is I'm all for Xtend. You know, and I think I'm better suited not planning stuff and more networking and getting access to relationships that you guys could find valuable. I mean, that's like, I'm better suited being on the phone connecting your dad to so-and-so that runs a network of pastors that doesn't currently know Xtend exists until I start that conversation, you know? So that's kind of how I served. But I was initially asked to host, and then I had a very funny thing happen where I got COVID extremely bad about 10 days before the conference.
First time ever.
And it was my first time getting COVID, and it wiped the crap out of me to the point where I wasn't actually able to physically host. And your brother, Marky, ended up stepping in and doing a great job. And I think they will never ask me to host again.
How'd you avoid it for 3 years and got it the day you needed to host something?
I know. So it was so sad.
Can you imagine that?
That's crazy.
The Lord was trying to teach me something. I still don't know the lesson. It must have been Mark's moment.
It might have been.
What was his moment? Yeah, he was great.
He was so nervous the day before.
He did great.
This was decided the night.
That timing is too crazy. It's like,
yeah, the night before the conference is when my brother found out he was hosting.
Yeah, he did great.
He did great.
Awesome. He brought the passion.
Talk about pressure, huh?
He did great. Well, it's cool. Yeah. It actually worked out pretty well because they asked me, hey, you know, we are having trouble finding a female host.
Yeah.
And it was funny because Rosie was one who called me and said, who do you want to host? And I said, you. Rosie, I would want, like, if you can get out of whatever job they have you doing the day of right now, I would want you to be the co-host with me because I think Rosie and I would have done really well together. And she was like, okay, like in classic Rosie, like laughing fashion. If you know Rosie, you understand what I'm talking about. She's like, okay, Scott, cool. And I was like, no, I'm dead serious. Like, can you just ask them if you can do it? And she did. She followed through, and everybody's like, of course, that makes sense. So whenever I got sick, like I felt like it was going to be fine because I knew Rosie was going to be fine because I think we had a pretty decent plan on what we were going to do together, and it was just giving that plan to Marky. So it ended up working out. I mean, I was bummed to not host, definitely sad, but it was a beautiful thing to get to still go. I was kind of hanging out in the rafters and hiding. And to witness everything. Before, like, we get into what exactly happened, I want to shout you out, though.
He was negative, by the way, when he showed
up. Yeah, I wasn't positive.
For all you guys who would be bugging right now. He just showed up there with COVID.
No, it was like 10 days, 10 days later. I just still felt tired and zapped. And I didn't want to, you know, give less than my full potential there. So, but I even want to just go back to your prep. Because we're talking about prepping for the conference. There's a lot. You prepped with rehearsals for this opportunity because it was a big deal.
Yeah.
And just talk me through like your rehearsal with Aunt G and Josh and that whole thing.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of the preparation happened at home. We were actually only able to get one actual rehearsal. So I just knew going into it, I wanted to do something that I've never done before. I feel like as an artist, you could stick to what works, and just, you know, I'll just pick a couple songs that you think would be exciting. But I wanted to try to challenge myself to be more intentional with how the songs went into one another and to just try to create moments. You know, I only had 10 minutes, so I wanted those 10 minutes to be just really good. And I think really I was feeling like I want the people who decided to trust me to feel like they made the right decision. I think that was really on my heart too. Like, obviously we do this for the Lord and we honor him and with our gifts and we're trying to, you know, be a blessing to all these youth students. But to be honest, I was also thinking like, I want to honor the people who are putting all this work in and sacrificing a lot of their time. I don't want to treat this like it's just another day, you know? So, yeah. Yeah, I did a lot of preparation, and the rehearsal itself was, you know, DJ Angie and Josh, they're very easy to work with. Like, they're just there to support me. They did a great job, like, hearing my vision and bringing it to life. And they're both really skilled at what they do, so it wasn't much to ask for them. Just get them the tracks and let them know what I'm trying to do, and then they executed really well, so...
Yeah, I mean, Angie, we shout him out on every episode because Angie's a big part of everything that we do. He was a DJ for the full conference, but then also obviously the DJ for the artist set with you. And he's kind of like an MD. You know, we talk about this a lot on this podcast. He doesn't just function as somebody who hits a button and plays a song. He's really the MD for a band. You know, he's like a one-man band. And then Joshua Shafe, Daddy Flex.
Yeah, how you doing? You know? No way.
The one and only. Josh is a beast, you know, and a phenomenal drummer. And I think what was cool was like he really put the time in to like learn every hit and design a way of playing every song that was unique to him.
He did.
He didn't just like do a job. He was like put his own flair on it.
He did. And there was a transition that was like in the middle of the beat. The beat sped up. The BPM changed mid beat and then it slowed down. And then it went back up again. So it was technical. Yeah. I was definitely experimenting.
You were being extra, yeah. But it was amazing.
It was.
That was partially why it made it so great. I appreciated just like to shout out what ended up happening in the rehearsal end of things. Like you said, you did something new and different because I think it would have been really easy for you to be like, all right, I'm going to do lip tint. I'm going to do fireproof.
Yep.
I'm gonna do songs that I've done 100 times
yeah.
at 100 different gigs now. I'm gonna do the best songs from those sets. Mm-hmm. But you were like, these are teenagers with a specific demographic in 2023, right? Like, it's a new era, new sound, and you brought out like different elements that connected with like where culture is right now, in a way that I just thought was like, you didn't take the easy route. You did something very fresh, very unique, and at whatever it is, 600 seconds, 60 seconds, a minute, 10 minutes, 600 seconds, I don't know. I think that's the right amount. You made every second count.
10 minutes. I think 10 minutes works.
You made every second count.
Yeah.
You know.
Thank you. And you suggested that I should get a dancer, which I wasn't really considering, but because you put that thought into my mind, that created one of the cooler moments of the set, bringing out my friend Cam. She's a 14-year-old, really talented dancer.
She ate.
She did ate. She left no crumbs.
She ate.
Left no crumbs.
She went out there. She was super nervous. She's just so awesome and sweet. And it was cool to like be able to give her that opportunity because I believe in her a lot, you know. So that was a really cool moment.
Yeah, and I just think it makes so much sense to put a 14-year-old on stage in front of other 14-year-olds because there's no gap between who I am and what I could be whenever they're your age, right? Like, it's inspiring in a different way. Even though she didn't have a microphone to preach or speak or sing, she still embodied something of, like, excellence and beauty and passion for Jesus as she danced. And I was just like, yeah, this is like a win-win-win. Like, anytime you can highlight and empower young people instead of just ministering down. I mean, that's our whole culture in RIPE is like, how do we lift up? How do we get kids on stage? How do we give the highlight the kids so that they feel empowered to live into something that they wouldn't have otherwise been challenged to be, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It was amazing. That was a really cool moment. Like, I've never done the whole flashlight at a concert thing. I've never asked people to do that. For one of my songs, somebody just pulled out a flashlight at the very top row. Like, they were all the way up there. And I remember all I said was, "I see that flashlight." And when I said that, I just saw like about 200, 300 more flashlights pop up in the arena. And I remember, I literally stopped and said, "Wow," like mid performance. Yeah. 'Cause I was just in awe. Like, you guys got to understand, man. Like, I don't feel like I'm about to go out there and, you know, I don't know. I mean, the whole Aable thing, I mean, it's literally 'cause like God is Aable, right? Like, I don't feel like I can do this. You know what I'm saying? It's just crazy to see God's faithfulness, is what I'm trying to say. And I think in that moment, it was really hitting me that was happening, that I was in that position. I was just, I was overwhelmed in the best way. It was really good.
Amen. That was the second set of the day, Resonate, into Aable, and then there was a message by Hannah. She killed it. She went out. She went off doing her thing.
Yeah.
And I think that right after Hannah was kind of like small groups into intermission, right?
Elevation Rhythm closed out the first set.
Yes. So Elevation Rhythm killed it.
Yeah, great.
Talk about having like a DNA for young people. They're probably like bar none on that front. You know, people that just like really connect with teenagers.
It was excellent.
In particular, so good. Yeah, after the intermission, there's like a brief intermission type of thing to get ready for the second half. CityReach Worship. Ow, ow!
Mm-hmm.
Ow, 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 ow. Came out on a stage having had zero sound checking time. And you would have never known. But yeah, Joe, talk to us about CityReach Worship on both of you. Yeah, tell us about it.
What a day that was. So from the CityReach Worship perspective, I think, so just for context, there's so many like details of the day of for a conference like that. And so down to like from the moment that door opens at 5 a.m., we have every minute kind of listed as far as what we're going to be doing. And so when it came to sound checking certain groups and teams, obviously the teams that fly in from far distances, they get priority. And CityReach is the home team, so we kind of take the punches and we just roll with it as we go.
We're prepared for anything.
And for even more context, the year before at the Leo Corps Center, our team also did not get a sound check. You know, the Lord still moved in such a beautiful way, but it became a running joke on our team, like, this year we will have our sound check.
And as the minutes counted down, we were like, maybe not.
Yeah. Yeah. So like, I mean, even like in all of rehearsals, I know Aaron was sharing his rehearsal times. We had a bunch of rehearsals throughout the year preparing. And I would always say that. I said, guys, this year, on to my witness, I would say this year, guys, we're getting our sound check. And lo and behold, the day of, we didn't get a sound check. And you know, just with all the things that happen in an event like that, when it comes closer to your time to actually go up and, for lack of a better word, perform, you just want to be as prepared as possible. And we were just not given all the best, what's the word? Like, we were not set up to feel very prepared.
But honestly, I'd rather it be us that go through that than any other people from whatever.
For sure.
I mean, like, I'm not tooting our own horn, but I'm saying we took that very seriously and we stewarded.
Yes.
We stewarded the time very well. I mean, thanks to everyone involved and like our fearless worship leader, Joseph. That's right. But no, like we really took the time and he really took the time to, for each rehearsal, to reiterate, like, this is not just a set. This is not just a song. Like, this is for a generation who needs to be empowered by their identity in Christ And like, and so like I said, like I'd rather it be us because it came from this, you know, Philly, like this is our heart for it. So yeah. We didn't care whatever happens. We're still going to do what we do because we love the city, and this is, it's not going to change anything whether we get a sound check or not.
Yeah. I think another big factor about our set was that we got to share it with a really close friend of ours. Her name is Layla Oliveira. She's an artist in her own regard, and she makes music. She's predominantly makes Spanish worship music, but she's amazing. And so we shared that set with her. And I kind of had to keep a strong face for the team, but in front of her, I was like, Layla, what are we going to do? She was like, Joe, we got it. You're going to be fine. And so we actually ended up changing. We had a whole different set list, actually. We changed our set list as well.
10 minutes before?
Right before we walked on stage with no sound
check.
5 minutes
before.
Yeah, something like that. Minutes before. Many major changes were made.
I remember we're standing in the circle and we're like, so yeah. We're doing this.
Yeah. And it was just, I mean, our team, and I don't say this just because I'm part of the team and I get to lead it, but it's just full of amazing people. And so I went out there, and as nervous as I was and as stressed out as I was, I really just felt peace. And I was, like Ann had said, I was just glad that I got to do it with those people. And so we were able to lead, and I really felt like we were able to just bring like a reverence to the day. And we got to see the whole entire room like drop to their knees and just surrender to the Lord. And did everything go as planned? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. But I think as long as the Lord was pleased and we just did what he wanted, I think it was a win for us. And so, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it went to somebody's plan.
Yeah.
Even if it wasn't to yours, you know. I think that's kind of the beauty of those kinds of moments, is like God makes you weak so that he can be strong. You know, and that's an intentional move on his end. That doesn't mean you plan for chaos or try to execute chaos, but it's like whenever it comes, do you trust that it's God's going to show up anyway and do his thing? Like, you know what I mean? You did everything right that you could have to not have those challenges, but they still came. And I think it's kind of funny that the very thing that maybe was a place of comfort and security of like, this time we're going to get this. The Lord ultimately in his sovereignty allowed for you to not get that. But I said this to you guys the day of, I thought the City Reach set was the best set of the day. Personally, this is a room for your city. Something you've prayed about it for a year, right? Like actively praying for God to move in this room, in these people's lives. And when you look out over the crowd, they're not a sea of faces. They're names to you. And that gives you such a like reverence and a broken heart, a broken and contrite heart before the Lord, that you're like, I want God to move in Natasha's life. Not in this room generically, but in her. Or in Brian, or in Sasha, you know what I mean? Like, I want this kid to get it. And I think there's just so much power in that. That's what I felt.
Yeah.
But the heart you guys carry, like, it's bar none, you know? And, yeah, I thought it was beautiful. Maybe I'm oversharing in this sense, but I just want to absolutely affirm what I affirmed the day of. I thought it was an amazing set. And who cares about comparing? It was a great set. It was exactly what it was meant to be. And it's a credit to all of you guys.
Praise God.
Thanks, Scott.
She said, praise God.
Thanks, Scott. Love you.
Absolutely love you, too. Anything from your end, Aaron, in terms of like the worship set stuff that you saw?
The whole day was just I was in a very worshipful place, right? So to be in the presence of people leading worship, I also thought City Reach did excellent, and I was also really blessed by Elevation Rhythm, but I think it was just really powerful to see a whole room of young people, and there were like adults there too. It was a mix, but there were a lot of young people, and we were all crying out to God for our different reasons, but ultimately giving him glory. And it was, I think, in any opportunity to be in a space like that is just, it always feels like, oh, this is bigger than me. and my problems and what I'm going through. Like, we're a body of believers with a mighty God.
Yes.
So I thought it was special.
Yeah. And then even like the messages, right? Like, it's easy to like pick apart a message, but then they say, hey, if you want to receive Jesus, come forward. And hundreds of people run forward. And you're just like, man, this is the beauty of our God, is that he uses what we could have done better. Like, he fills in the gaps. Like, I mean, I can't, some of the most powerful nights of my life have happened whenever I felt like I fumbled and I didn't put my best foot forward. And I felt like, man, I wasn't how I wanted to communicate that thing. But God just tends to move in that place of, it didn't go the way I wanted, but he was all the more glad to use it. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's the beauty of, you're giving space for God to move. Right, you can't force his hand, but you can ask. You know, you can't command God to go somewhere as if he's your dog on a leash, right? And I think we got to be careful with that sometimes, where we use language of like telling God where to go, like, yeah. We're the one with authority. No, he has the authority. Yes, does he give us authority? Sure, but we are not God that we can make God move in that sense. Faith does compel God, though. You know what I mean? Faith does move God. You know, that's Jesus was astonished by people of faith, right? It surprised him. And I think your dad, as one person, you know, that's a part of a larger whole that puts this whole thing together, is, like you've said, a man of faith. And him just believing, let's do it. Let's create space for God to move. Let's make it excellent. Let's plan the best we can. Let's put it all together. Let's step out in faith. And of course, God's going to save in a room like that. You know, so all the salvations that came, all the young people coming forward, you know, repenting and turning from sin. You know, I was sick as a dog, and I don't know who it was. Might have been your mom, probably. It's like, you need to go pray for some people. I was like, oh, geez, I'm tired. But I had like powerful moments with people that were in their 40s and 50s that were coming forward, bawling their eyes out because they were compelled by the message that was written for the 13-year-old, you know, and like needing to repent of sin. And I got to pray over them and kind of speak some truth about their identity and grace and the gospel and, you know, how the forgiveness of God works and how secure it really is when we confess and believe. So it was kind of like a really crazy, cool ministry space. But yeah, I mean, it's not to compare who did what or whatever. It's like just God moved. Like, at the end of the day, forget how anybody individually did. God was moving through Xtend.
Amen. That's the goal.
Anything from your end on that you kind of experienced over the course of the day?
The day was wild because I was on worship, but I was also running social media.
She ran the Instagram story and posting all that for the day of.
It was very fun.
That was you?
That was me.
With the team, but it was leading the charge.
I had the privilege. I had the privilege of doing that. Thank you for trusting me, Joe. I was scared just a little bit, but I had so much fun. It was really amazing, though, to try to capture what was happening as the day was going by and showing people a snippet, you know, like, because that's social media. You only get a little snippet. But I was running around and asking people to get videos and testimonies and just hearing from people of how excited they were to be there, of what they were receiving, and to get the behind the scenes of everybody. It was just very fun, but also to see how everyone's heart was just united. It was unity, like everywhere around. It was just pure unity, and everyone was doing everything in excellence. And like, numbers are not important in the sense of like who sees it, but to see how many people were there, but also how many people had their eyes on it, on the stories and whatnot, was just like mind blowing that we get to showcase this on that scale and to see and to show people that like, this is happening in your very own city. This is happening in your very own region, that revival is not just about the places that you just hear about over and over and over again, but like in a place like Philadelphia, this is possible, that God is moving on this scale, God is saving on this scale, God is healing on this scale and delivering on this scale. Like, this is here, this is now. And to be able to show that was just like such a privilege and an honor, and brought unity. So I had a lot of fun. I was kind of literally frantically running most of the day because I was trying to get back on time for our supposed sound check and whatnot.
Mind you, I think I had texted the team about 10 times. Guys, sound check's now. Yeah. They'd all come down. Emily's a witness to this as well. Like, yeah. They'd all come down, and then I was like, actually, no, not yet.
I lied.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, guys.
Yeah, and it was like really fun because the previous year at the Leader Course, I was leading photo, and it was just a very different dynamic. When you're leading photo, I was basically in one room, just managing who is sent out and who is editing, what gets uploaded when, and just that, all that sense. So I was basically very stationary. But this year, being on social media and worship, I was quite literally everywhere on every level possible and sending out people to where I couldn't be at the same time. But to be able to cover and to see everything, kind of like get a bird's eye view of everything, it was very much everyone's heart was in the same place of like, we just want to do things in excellence. And it's not just a job, but also we want to see God's glory get revealed through every little thing. No matter if it's like the greeters, no matter if it's like 5 a.m. prep for production, whether it's the people on stage and making sure sound is great and making sure that everyone just feels loved when they walk in, to the very people that are praying for the salvation call and whatnot. Like, yeah. Everyone was just on it. Nobody was like, what do I do? But everyone was just, what can we do? You know?
It's good. What a team. It's crazy. This is how God works. An doesn't have these notes in front of her. And I said, overall value of Philly having a large-scale youth conference versus leaving to other places, right? And she just went through the here in Philadelphia. You're going to see deliverance of it, right? Crazy. And I said, blessing Xtend and the way it can be a touch point to bring ministries together in unity. And that's what you just drove home. And like, that's literally all my notes to wrap up this episode with, because I think that those two things are huge. Like, here, Philadelphia, Xtend, God is doing something. He's doing, and by the way, it's not just through Xtend, right? He's moving throughout the city, but I think Xtend is a piece of the puzzle and it's important because it is a connection point for a lot of other ministries. And I know there's a goal for the future of Xtend. Like, how do we get space to connect more ministries to one another through even like the vending aspect of it, right? The Met doesn't maybe necessarily lend itself to being able to do that at scale. But what does it look like to connect at, you know, the Young Lifes and the CCOs and the InterVarsities and, you know, the Ripes of the world, like all these different ministries that exist in the ecosystem of our region to one another. And I just think like that stuff brings unity. And when there's unity, I just think God moves. You know, there's something about unity that it shows us to be his disciples, right? That it shows the world that we really are followers of Jesus when there's unity. And I don't know. I mean, I've been preaching this for a long time. It's been 10, 15 years of me saying the exact same thing. But I think all the more as we see the day of Christ approaching, unity is on the uptick in our region. Like, it's like a Maranatha, both in, like, come Lord Jesus, right? Come quickly, Lord Jesus. Like, there's a, as we see Jesus coming, and we know that every day we're closer to that, I think a part of that is an outpouring of the Spirit that you see through unity. And that might be vague and like a little bit too churchy for some, but I just think it's a fact, like, that those two things are coinciding in the city of Philadelphia in particular. So thank you guys for being a part of it. You know, it's not just a conference.
Yeah.
It's like a part of heaven's plan for our region, you know, like when you pray, your kingdom come, your will be done in Philadelphia as it is in heaven. When Joseph sings, on all the Philadelphia
ocean. Amen. Can I add that the verse, the overarching verse over the conference was 1 Peter 2:9, but it says, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into marvelous light." That was what we were drilling into these kids' minds, into this generation's mind, into Philadelphia's mind, that like for a place with so much darkness surrounding, like, oh, when you hear of Philly, like, that's what you hear of. You hear of violence, you hear of crime. Everybody wants to put you down, basically. But, like, this is the word of God, and that's being proclaimed over this generation. And it kind of, like, just shakes you up. It shakes you up, and it builds you up. Because that's what the word of God does. And for a city like this, and for a region like this, we need it now more than ever. And I think for the kids to see other people from outside coming in and believing in that as well is also empowering. So, like, I love the fact that people came in and, like, believed this for Philly when we couldn't believe it for ourselves too. So that's, like, just another layer of unity of the body of Christ. Like, when one is lacking, or when one needs help, or when one needs just a little more push, then, like, the body is ready to, like, push and, like, help drive it in, where it's like, sometimes we don't always believe this, but everyone is, like, all hands on deck and reminding us, like, no, this is it. Yeah.
Amen. So good, guys. Listen, we could probably talk about it all night, but we will we'll wrap things up here. I just want to encourage you, if you're here listening to this podcast, Xtend 2020, whatever, by the time you hear this, if it's 2024 or 2025, if you listen to this a year from now, you know, look it up, you know, go to the next one, get connected to this thing, especially if you're in the Philadelphia region, but even from further beyond, like, come get a taste of what God's doing, in the next generation here in Philly. Yeah. And just want to say to all of the people who listen to this podcast that partner with us and Ripe Creatives, you know, your generosity is a part of, like, us being a part of Xtend. Like, whether you realize it or not, your generosity is a part of what gives us the capacity to go and serve, or to create relationship and connections for us to be more involved in a thing like Xtend. So when you give to us, you're supporting other ministries that we partner with through supporting what we do, and vice versa. So, I mean, it's all one big happy family, you know, like, we're just one conduit for blessing in the city of Philadelphia. But if you want to support what God's doing out here, Ripe Creatives is definitely one way you can do that. Through our website, ripecreatives.com, you can click the give button and give a donation or become a monthly partner. If you already support us, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for partnering with us so that we get to go do stuff like this, to be a part of what God is doing in a region, is because of your partnership that we have this opportunity. So thank you. And this podcast episode is really just us trying to say, like, here's how your resource is being stewarded, is through stuff like the story of Xtend. So Joe, on Aable / Aaron, any final thoughts before we shut this whole thing down?
No, I think just to echo what An had said, I think the biggest thing for me, conference is over, we're walking out, everything's done. The image that just stays in my mind is seeing the individual faces in the audience just, like, being encountered by the Lord. And just this idea that we get to charge a room full of thousands of middle schoolers and high schoolers to now put into practice the things that that they were just empowered with. And so now that in their families, and in their schools and their classrooms, in their first period, second period, third period, like, in their after school clubs, like, they're not the same person that they were. And I mean, we've heard testimonies from people, young people, that were battling with suicide or battling with situations at home. I just heard a story of a friend of mine, a personal friend of mine, actually a friend of me and aunt's. She brought her younger sister to Xtend. Her younger sister doesn't really have a relationship with the Lord, and that was the first time she felt like she felt something. And so the stories like that, even the hundreds that we'll never hear, I think those make it all worth it. And the years worth of work and all those things, those come to a beautiful, it's like a beautiful bow on it. When you leave out of the Met that day, tired, stressed, maybe a little disappointed, but then the Lord just shows you the little girl who was crying in the front row and the little boy like in the back who was on his knees with his arms raised. And it's like, okay, it was worth it. Yeah, I think that's the last thing. I think last thing I'll say, just, I wanted to say this when we were talking about your set, but I didn't. Scott just moved on so fast. But
I'm sorry.
I did think Aaron just crushed it. He did so good. Like, I knew when we were planning for a local rapper to come in our, we do weekly meetings. I said, there's no other option. Like, I have a lot of friends that are in Christian hip hop in the city, but just for what I knew, what we were trying to do, I knew Aaron was the only option. And so when he came, when he did his thing, I think every worship team was able to lead the room into a beautiful moment. But what Aaron did was so specific and so, it was just so beautiful to see. And so I think I was just super blown away by how you led. Because obviously it's easy to say, oh, he's just going to rap. He's just going to entertain the room. But every second that you had, I think Scott said it was 600 seconds, something like that.
Hey.
Every second, I think, was so, was just so well executed. And I think even having the young girl come out and dance was just so perfect. The things you said in between songs are so perfect. And the way you just commanded the room, and the Holy Spirit just gave you this authority over the room. I was like, man, he could have told those kids to just like run in circles, and they probably would have. Like, it was just like,
should have like repent right now.
Repent. But I was just super, I knew you were going to do great, or otherwise I was like, I would have never have been like, let's go with Aaron. But I was just so, sorry, Aable. I was just so blown away. And last thing, I had two cousins come with me from Chicago, not come with me, but two of my cousins from Chicago, they flew down to be there for the day of. And afterwards, I was like, well, what was your favorite part? And they were like, the rapper was just so amazing. I was like, what about me? Like, I sang, I'm your cousin. Like, yeah, you guys were great, but man, that rapper guy, he was just so amazing. And so, yeah, that's it. That's all I'll say.
Thank you for your kind words.
You're welcome, sir.
That's encouraging.
Sorry to add on, because you were saying in the beginning that like you didn't feel like, I don't know, you were worthy of like being up there in that space, but like I fully know with all of my heart that God trusted you with that because He knows your heart. Mm-hmm. And so like you were given the platform, but you have been preparing for that by the way that you live. You know, you prepared with practicing and whatnot, but like you lived it out. And I think because of that, like it resonated with the kids, the students, and the families, and literally everyone that was there, like or who was there, like they fully were in it because you lived it, you know. Okay,
yeah. Go ahead, exhortation gift.
Amen. Thank you, guys. Yeah, I didn't. Thank you for trusting me, you know, you and the whole squad. You know, I didn't know how it'd go, but, you know, God has been preparing me. Me and Scott have been on a lot of adventures, and I feel like we've, from where we started, you know, him and I sometimes just reflect on where we started and how God has been kind of leading the whole journey, you know. So, I was just in awe. I don't know. I was in awe, but I think my final thoughts actually do make me think of, ironically, the big conference makes me think of the everyday life. Just like living every day in the mundane moments, seeking to be obedient to God and not only looking to the big, I'm kind of sharing this. If you're listening out there, like we're talking about a big conference where God moved powerfully. But God also, I believe, wants to move powerfully in our everyday lives.
Yeah.
And we don't have to wait for the big moments. We can be obedient in our daily lives and see how He's impacting the people around you. if we're just willing to say yes. Yeah, I love Xtend Conference. I hope that I get to be a part of it again. You know what I'm saying? God willing.
Period. I don't make those decisions, but yeah. Yeah. Go, Aaron.
If not, I'll be there. If not, I'll be there anyway. You know what I mean? We're still going to always support what God is doing in this city. So,
amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Love you guys. Thank you for tuning in. It's been a long one. Top Mop, Jared Moses. We appreciate you.
Love you.
And all of your work behind the scenes to edit these beautiful things so that they come out better than they would have if we didn't edit. I can tell you that much. Thank you for tuning in. And what a year it's been. 2023 events here with Ripe Creatives. God has been moving in powerful ways. We've been blessed to be a part of other people's things, blessed to do some of our own things. All of it, as Aaron said, it's just about the day that we're living out. And that's why we do this podcast in this way. We're just highlighting moments in time to give a glimpse of how God's moving, you know, through a specific space. But it's day in, day out. Please keep us lifted in prayer. If you're a prayer person, person who prays, has a relationship
prayer,
with God.
If you're a prayer.
If you're just checking this thing out, we love you. Please reach out to us at Ripe Creatives, and we'd love to be in touch. Until next time, y'all, as always, stay right.
Stay right, bye.
Stay right.
Stay right.
My life an hourglass, secure in his hands. Never been more sure when I'm seeing the sense. And I got